Hello, welcome to Willow Hill and everyone joining us for worship today. We are so blessed to worship with you. My name is Lee Hager. I'm the Director of Online Ministries, and I'm excited to welcome you to our new sermon series, Tell Me the Stories of Jesus. This week, Pastor Nicole will share the message, Tell Me the Story of Jesus and the Lost Sheep. If you are new here, welcome. We're so glad you're here, and we would love a chance to get to know you a little bit better. So please consider filling out that digital connection card, which is linked in the video's description, or you can scan that QR code on your screen. Like I said, it gives us a chance to get to know you a little bit better, and it's an opportunity for you to submit any prayer requests you might have so the staff can pray alongside you. If you're joining us from your television, we encourage you to pull out your cell phone or tablet and join us in the comments. We would love to hear from and engage with you there. Anything you like, any insights you might have, we'd love to see you in the comments. Also, pulling out your cell phone or tablet gives you an opportunity to scan any QR codes that might pop up on your screen. So that's very helpful for you as well. And we encourage you to share this worship service with anyone you think might be blessed by it. If you would like to get to know Willow Hill a little bit more, you can check out our website, willowhill.org, or you can find us on social media through Facebook, Instagram, and our YouTube channel. At this time, we encourage you to lift your voices as we sing our opening song.
You must think I'm strong to give me what I'm going through. Forgive me if I'm wrong, but this looks like more than I can do on my own. I know I'm not strong enough to be everything that I'm supposed to be. I give up, not strong enough. Hands of mercy, won't you cover me?
Strong enough. Hi, friends. I'm Pastor Nicole. I'm going to lead us in a time of prayer. I'll give us just a moment to connect our heart to God's heart. I will then pray a prayer for us, and at the end, we can join together in the Lord's Prayer. Let us go to God. God of all creation, we gather today to bring glory to your name, for you alone are worthy of our praise. May all that we sing and say and do today be sweet to your ears. We lift up to you the many prayer requests that we have. We know that you have heard each and every prayer of our hearts, and we pray that you would be with those who are ill and recovering, those who are hurt or depressed or feeling lost. And we pray that you would bring hope to those who are in need. Make your love evident. God, we pray that you would help each of us to be a light in this dark world. Help us to shine your love into those dark places. Help us to love our neighbor and to always be listening for your call. We realize that we are all called to serve this community, tasked with sharing your love and your peace with others. So help us to be vigilant of opportunities to love others well. We ask all of these things in the name of your Son, Jesus, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Hi, friends. It is time for small talk. I brought a bag of animals to share with you. See, when my kids were little, they loved animals. So we used to collect animals wherever we went. And they are so interesting. I thought I would share some of them with you and just talk about some of these animals. And I want to start with, where is it? There's one I want to start with. I can't find it. Well, those are interesting, but where is the one that I'm looking for? I just can't find it anywhere. I know it's in here somewhere. No, I don't want to talk about those yet because I really want to find this one. I want to make sure I have everything here. Where is it? Oh, I know. I need to keep going here, but I have to find this animal. Where could it be? Oh. I found it. This is one of my animals that I wanted to share with you. There's so many interesting animals that we could talk about and learn about, but I really, really wanted to make sure this one was in there. I was so afraid that this little lamb was lost, but I found it. I'm so excited that I found this little lamb in this package of all of these animals. I know there were so many animals that I could have just started with and told you about, but I wanted to make sure that this little lamb did not get left out, was not lost, because he's so cute. And just like all the other animals, there's something interesting about them, and they're exciting. And I just love all these little animals. They look so real. Now, this little lamb in particular reminds me of a story that Jesus told in the Bible. And the story is about a shepherd who had 100 sheep. Yeah, 100 of them. And it was time to take them all home. They had been out grazing in the pasture. It was time to take them home when the shepherd counted and realized he only had 99 sheep. That means one was missing. one was lost. But he still had 99, right? Shouldn't he take those 99 home? But you know what Jesus said the shepherd did? Before the shepherd took those 99 home, the shepherd went out searching, like I searched in my bag. The shepherd searched and searched until he found the little lost sheep. And he carried the sheep on his shoulders and brought that sheep back to the flock and was so excited, celebrating because he found the one that was lost. Just like I was excited when I found my one little sheep in my bag of lots and lots of animals. Now, what are we supposed to learn from that story that Jesus told? Well, I wonder if one of the things we can learn is that, like that shepherd knew that every single one of the sheep were important. And it was the shepherd's job to take care of every sheep. Even though he had all these 99, he still had to take care of that one. Did not want one sheep to feel lost or not taken care of. I wonder if that can remind us of God and how God loves every single person on this earth. That's right, every person. Now, God loves the people that are in church with us, the people that we know that know about God's love. But God doesn't stop there. God wants to find every person in the whole world. God wants every single person to know that they're loved by God and that they're cared for by God and that they are part of God's family. And I wonder if we can be a part of that too. If we can help other people know that God loves them. That we might be able to think of somebody that might not know about God or that might think that they're not important or not loved by God. I wonder if each one of us can find someone and let them know that they are loved, that they are welcome here with us, that they are welcome in our lives, and we can help them know God's love by loving them too. So maybe next time you're out somewhere, you're out at a park or you're at the swimming pool or you're just hanging out with friends and you see someone that might feel a little left out, that might look like they're lonely or sad, I wonder if you can find a way to invite them to be a part of your group and let them know that they are welcome, that they are loved, not only by you, but especially loved by God. Let's see if we can all help look for someone who needs to feel loved, included, or welcome. And let's see if we can help be like that shepherd so that everyone in the world can know that they are loved by God. Let's fold our hands and say our sentence prayer. Dear God, thank you for loving all of us and for finding us when we are lost. Please help us share your love with every person we meet. Amen. See you next time.
Well, today I am giving thanks for the many ways that Willow Hill continues to impact us. Whether we are in-person worshipers or online worshipers, I am giving thanks for the ways that this ministry has helped us to grow in our faith, has helped us to connect to God, has helped us to grow. And I want to thank you because of your generosity. We are able to be the church that God has called us to be. We are able to be Willow Hill. And so I want to thank you for all the ways that you continue to financially support the ministry of this church so that we can reach out to our community and all around the world in the name of Jesus. We have a couple of different ways that you can give today. You can use the QR code on your screen. You can also use the link in the description of this video, or you can go online to our website, willowhill.org. If you'd rather, you can drop by a check to the office or mail it in. However you choose to give, know that you are making a difference and we are grateful. Would you join me in prayer? Oh God, we are grateful to be gathered from wherever we are and to lift our hearts up in worship of you. We pray that you would open our ears that we might hear your still small voice. Speak to us, God. We are listening. Amen. Well, many moons ago, I was a youth pastor in charge of an ecumenical youth choir of around 125 kids. High school kids, that is. And every summer, we would go on a 10-day tour to do some sightseeing and to lead worship in churches around the country. One summer, we were headed to Washington, D.C., so we loaded around 100 kids and adults into two charter buses, and we made our way east. Now, this wasn't my first rodeo. I had gone on these trips before, and I knew what to expect. You might think that traveling with 100 high school students might be a challenge, and sometimes it was,
But for the most part, they were very well behaved. They knew where they were supposed to be and when. And it helped that I had several adults helping to herd them around. Well, on this particular trip to Washington, D.C., it was going fairly well. I hadn't had to take anybody to the emergency room yet. We hadn't lost anyone, and everyone seemed to be in a fairly good mood. That was until Wacky Wednesday hit. Now, we called it Wacky Wednesday because, for whatever reason, on Wednesday of these 10-day trips, things always went wackadoo. And this Wednesday was no exception. The plan for the day was to split into two groups. One bus would head with half of the kids and go tour the White House. The other half of the students would go to tour the Pentagon. And we were on a tight schedule because apparently they don't like it when you roll up to a tour late with a bunch of kids. I guess it's a security issue or something. So we knew that we were on a tight time schedule. We got the kids up, got them ready, got them to eat breakfast. We got everything that they needed for the day, loaded them on the bus, and guess what? We had three kids missing. We called them, no answer. We asked their friends where they were, they didn't know. So we decided to have the other bus go ahead to the Pentagon so that they wouldn't miss their tour. And then we, the adults on my bus, got to searching for those kids. Obviously, we weren't going to leave them behind. We finally found them, got everyone loaded onto the bus, and took off for the White House. And we arrived 10 minutes late, and they wouldn't let us in. So instead of touring the White House, we waited in a park close by for the other half of our kids to finish their tour of the Pentagon. It wasn't exactly what we had planned for that fun morning. But you know what? No one questioned whether we made the right decision or not. It was obviously the right decision. We weren't gonna leave kids behind, and so it was worth delaying the rest of the group in order to find the missing kids. And even though I have still never seen the inside of the White House, it was worth it to make sure we had all of our kids with us. Well, today we're gonna take a look at a story where Jesus has a little something similar to share. It's a story about a group of sheep delayed from going home until one lost sheep is found. But before we get to that, let me welcome you to our new sermon series, Tell Me the Stories of Jesus. Over the next few weeks, we are going to be looking at stories from the Gospels. Some will be stories or parables that Jesus told. Others will be stories about things Jesus did or said. But each week, we will have the opportunity to connect to the heart of the gospel and to fall deeper in love with Jesus and his message for us. So, without further ado, let's take a look at Luke 15, verses 1 through 7. All the tax collectors and sinners were gathering around Jesus to listen to him. The Pharisees and legal experts were grumbling, saying, "This man welcomes sinners and eats with them." So Jesus told them a parable. Suppose someone among you had 100 sheep and lost one of them. Wouldn't he leave the other 99 in the pasture and search for the lost one until he finds it? And when he finds it, he is thrilled and places it on his shoulders. And when he arrives home, he calls together his friends and neighbors, saying to them, "Celebrate with me, because I found my lost sheep." In the same way, I tell you that there will be more joy in heaven over one sinner who changes both heart and life than over 99 righteous people who have no need to change their hearts and lives. So Jesus tells us a story of a lost sheep. And in the story, the shepherd delays taking the other 99 sheep home until he finds the one lost sheep. And this story is made to make us kind of scratch our heads and ask the question, why? Why would the shepherd leave 99 perfectly healthy sheep to go looking for one? Why would he put those 99 sheep in danger in order to find just one. As one commentary writer puts it, either the shepherd is a fool, or he loves the lost sheep and will risk everything to find it. Now, of course, we know the answer. The shepherd isn't a fool. The shepherd loves the sheep. And this is the story of God, that things that look foolish to the world aren't foolish from God's perspective. Things that don't make sense to the world are the way of God. It doesn't make logical sense, and it doesn't have to. God will chase after one sheep over and over again because God loves the sheep and isn't willing to lose the sheep. Part of the reason I think it seems like foolishness is because we cannot see the whole of the picture. We only see part of what is going on. When I was younger, I was a 4-H kid. Not a raise animals kind of 4-H kid, but an arts and crafts kind of 4-H kid. And I remember one year my mom teaching me how to cross stitch so that I could make a project to be submitted for judging. And the plan was that I was going to make this floral cross stitch pattern, and I would use it to make a pillow that was going to match my bedspread that my mom had made for me years before. And I was so excited to try this out. Now, it wasn't easy. I worked so hard on that cross stitch, section by section. I'd move it to a new area in the hoop so I could work on it. And I remember at times looking at the back part of the cross stitch and thinking that I had really messed this up. It was awful. There were knots all over the place. There was string going from here to there. It was a mess. It looked like a disaster. But when you turned it over and saw the right perspective, it actually turned out pretty darn good. What looked like a mess from one side wasn't a mess at all. And I think that's how it is with God sometimes, that what seems like foolishness to the world isn't foolishness at all. The world just can't see what God can see. The world can't understand what God understands. Now, this parable is actually the first in a series of three parables in this chapter in Luke 15. The parable of the lost sheep, parable of the lost coin, the parable of the lost son, or sometimes we call it the parable of the prodigal son. And all three of these parables are really about the same thing, joy. The joy of finding something that was lost. When we lose something precious to us, there's great joy when we find what we've lost. If you've ever lost something that meant a lot to you and then found it, that's a glimmer of what Jesus is talking about here. There's joy in finding lost things. And for God, finding the lost brings God great joy. This whole chapter, Luke 15, is all about the joy God has in finding the lost. But here's the thing about these stories. While it tells us that God finds great joy in finding the lost, it is also a reminder that that joy is offensive to some. And I know that sounds weird, but it's true. Sometimes we find ourselves offended by the celebration. Have you ever been offended by somebody else's celebration? Have you ever found yourself annoyed at somebody else's joy? When we lived in Springfield, we had some neighbors who loved an outdoor Saturday night party. Now, I don't think of myself as a party pooper, but Saturday night at a pastor's house is pretty chill. I'm usually home early, making sure things are ready for the next day. I'm looking over my sermon. I'm getting to bed nice and early so that I'm ready for Sunday morning. I'm definitely not a stay out late and celebrate on a Saturday night kind of gal. But, like I said, my neighbors in Springfield loved a Saturday night party. And if it was nice out,
They loved an outdoor Saturday night party. So many a Saturday night, I'd be trying my best to fall asleep, and I'd be listening to their music blaring, their hooting and hollering. One night in particular, I remember trying to fall asleep, and all I could hear them blasting was Lionel Richie's All Night Long. The irony was ridiculous. I was so annoyed at their celebration. One person's celebration can be an annoyance to somebody else. And this is certainly true when it comes to the good news of the gospel. A professor I had in seminary used to say that the finding of the lost is the offense of the gospel. And what did she mean by that? That some people have it in their mind who's in and who's out. And the Pharisees were just such people. They found themselves incredibly frustrated with Jesus because Jesus was hanging out with all of these people. He was eating dinner with sinners and prostitutes and celebrating with heathens. And the Pharisees found it offensive. How dare Jesus celebrate with those kind of people? Now, I think it's easy for us to look at the Pharisees and think, ugh, they are the worst. I'm so glad I'm not like them. But sometimes I wonder if we're more like the Pharisees than we care to admit. Are there people in our world that we don't want to be a part of the church because we think they are sinners? Are there people that we would rather look down on rather than welcome in? Have you ever noticed that sometimes Christians want grace for themselves and then judgment for other people? I mean, it doesn't take much asking around to hear horror stories from people of how they've been treated by other Christians, how they've been kicked out of the church, or how they've been told they were sinners and weren't allowed, or how they've been shamed for some part of who they are or some situation that they've found themselves in. But it's not our call on who deserves grace. We don't get to claim it for ourselves and then wish judgment on others. It's not how it works. God is in charge of grace. And God says grace is for everyone. Jesus says that God will search for the lost sheep until it is found. And when it is found, and that's not an if, it's a when it is found, all of heaven will be rejoicing. And so we can choose. Will we rejoice at the grace shown to the lost? Or will we be like the Pharisees and be annoyed by the celebration? One of my favorite theologians, N.T. Wright, says this: all of heaven is rejoicing, and if we don't rejoice too, we are out of tune with God's reality. And I don't know about you. I don't want to be out of tune with God's reality. I want to be very in tune with God's reality. So if heaven is rejoicing when the lost are found, I better be rejoicing too. And better yet, I want to be a part of the search party. I want to be helping God to find the lost, making sure that the outcasts are welcome, partnering with God to do his good work in the world. I want to be a part of the search party to help find and welcome those who are feeling lost and isolated and alone. Because here's the truth, friends. There's nothing different about that sheep that was lost. It wasn't lost because it was different or because something was wrong with it. It was just a sheep that had taken a wrong turn or got distracted by something along the way. It wasn't different from the other sheep. It wasn't meant to be outcast or forgotten or shamed or excluded. The shepherd loved the lost sheep as much as the shepherd loved any of the sheep. That lost sheep was just as important, just as missed, just as treasured. All the sheep are loved, and all of us are loved.
every single one of us. So if you find yourself feeling lost, I want to remind you that Jesus won't give up on searching for you. If you find yourself at a place that in life that feels unfamiliar or dark or scary or unknown, know that the shepherd is with you. You aren't alone, even if you feel like you are. You will be brought back home soon. And guess what? There's already a celebration planned. If you find yourself as one of the 99 sheep in the herd, I want to remind you that the celebrating is happening when that sheep is found. And that celebration doesn't mean that you aren't loved by the shepherd. It doesn't mean that you aren't valued by the shepherd. It doesn't mean that you aren't special. It just means that the lost sheep was found and a celebration needed to happen. And the shepherd invites the rest of the sheep to join in, on the celebration. And wouldn't it be a shame? Wouldn't it be a shame if we missed out because we were being too much like the Pharisees? So know this, that shepherd loves all of his sheep, each and every one. And whether you are lost or you are found, the shepherd is glad that you are a part of his flock. Would you pray with me, please? Oh God, we are grateful for this story, that reminds us of whether we are found or lost, you are with us, that you love us all, and that there is great celebration when a lost one is found. We pray, God, that you would help us to celebrate along with you, that you would help us to be a part of the search party, going out and looking for those lost sheep and welcoming them home. Jesus, be with us. Help us to be the sheep you created us to be. It's in your name that we pray. Amen. Well, this worship service has ended, but your life in Christ goes on and on. May your peace be so real and your joy so evident that all who see you come to know God. Amen.